It's happening. Ship 31 rolls to Massey's. Will it spark this time? Tower 2 on the move, when stack? A not-so-reusable launch pad, how will they fix it? Another hurricane on its way, only this time it is big. And a Chinese rocket performs a not-so-static-static fire. My name is Felix, welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. This week is packed with exciting news, with testing of Flight 6 hardware underway and Tower 2 about to commence stacking. Things are looking good for the future of Starbase. But some things still need to be overcome. Want to find out more? Let's do this, follow me. Today's journey will bring us to the launch site, where we can finally admire the unobstructed view of Starship's first orbital launch pad. With the old vertical tank farm now history, SpaceX will be filling in the space with prefabricated tanks and the equipment to support them. This new and improved tank farm will be able to supply propellant to both the old and new launch towers at Starbase. It should also be able to withstand a launch from Tower 1, contrary to the old tanks, which looked like Swiss cheese after some flights. However, we may see fewer flights from Tower 1 in the future. This is because this launch pad was the first, and because of that, it still has a few rough areas that aren't fully developed yet. For starters, it is fast approaching a point where the rockets it launches are more reusable than itself. An excellent example of this is the ship's quick disconnect, which is once again receiving considerable attention. We predicted this may be the case, as the previous liquid oxygen line appeared to be in poor shape post-flight. This isn't the first time SpaceX has had to perform repairs on the quick disconnect arm, as we also saw teams repairing a broken actuator just after Flight 4. SpaceX needs to ensure these launch towers can withstand not just one launch, but hundreds, and as of now, Tower 1 has a ways to go. The launch mount has also been a headache, with many pieces needing repairs or replacement. Even now, the launch mount may be slowing down SpaceX's work, as Booster 12 still needs to be static fired, but the mount is still undergoing repairs after Flight 4. Damn. You can also tell that this isn't a perfect design from all the man lifts needed to access it for any maintenance and repairs. While it may look awesome to see all of them go up all the time, it's a rather bad way of accessing a structure. This is why SpaceX has opted to change the whole design of the launch mount for pad number 2. We are finally seeing work commencing on the new launch mount in the form of more auger action. If you recall, just before SpaceX started on the base of Tower 2, they began placing foundation piles for the tower. They did this to ensure the tower's massive weight could be supported by the ground beneath it, which in the case of Starbase is mud, sand, and water. So instead of relying on that, SpaceX drills down to the bedrock layer and places large concrete and rebar piles similar to stilts to support the weight. This same process is now underway with the new launch mount, as the auger which places the piles is hard at work. This new launch pad is supposed to be a complete redesign, including a flame trench, but other than that information, the design might remain a complete mystery until construction is fairly underway. Another question right now is the current design of the launch tower for Pad 2. The height is still a bit of a mystery to us because of slightly contradicting information. As of now, Musk has stated that the tower will be significantly taller and the crane seems overqualified to take a tower the same size as Tower 1. But to make much of a height difference, the tower would need more segments to be built, and we have seen little to no sign of that happening. And on top of all that, SpaceX is finally moving forward with stacking operations, so a taller tower is getting less and less likely. But before I tell you about that, we've looked into our channel metrics, and over 2 million returning monthly viewers have not subscribed yet. Help us improve the channel even further by double checking that you've hit that subscribe button so you do not miss our updates. And while you're at it, give us a like and become a Y supporter for exclusive SpaceX updates. With it, you get access to daily Starbase photo galleries, including satellite, aerial, and ground photos of SpaceX's progress and countless other extras on top. And no matter how much you decide to give, everyone gets the same supporter content and access. You decide what you want to give. Alright, stacking time. On the night of the 2nd, the first segment of Tower number 2 was placed onto a pair of self-propelled modular transporters, or SPMTs, and escorted to the launch site for stacking. It is on! This was a bit of a surprise to us, as the road closure for that night specifically stated it was to roll a booster vehicle. Due to this, we believed Booster 12 would roll for its static fire. However, it seems that these closure advisories are increasingly more of a suggestion than a fixed reason for that roll.
Lies and deceit.
Now, with one segment at the launch site, only 6 of the 9 segments remain at Sanchez. Now, we can't do the Star Trek joke anymore. Teams are still hard at work preparing the rest for stacking by installing even more piping, including the main methane and oxygen lines for the ship QD. Of course, that still leaves 2 tower sections unaccounted for. Those are, of course, still waiting for their roll from the port of Brownsville to Sanchez, along with the chopsticks. The only piece truly unaccounted for now is the ship's quick disconnect. But that may be inside one of the few remaining tents at Starbase or at another place outside of Starbase getting ready for delivery. Since we're right next door, let's take a look at the progress being made at the build site, which is just a few steps away. We'll start at the parking garage. So exciting, I know. But give it a second, because this is actually a pretty important building. This building will offer additional parking for employees, and as you can see, it is really needed. Parking so many cars right next to the road is dangerous. The garage will likely be online soon, as workers have been seen painting the entire structure a dark gray. This will help the building fit the aesthetics of the rest of the buildings on that side of the build site. More importantly, paint will serve as a protection against moisture and UV rays, among other things. This process is nearly done, and only one exterior wall lacks paint. If I had to guess, I would say that the parking garage will be done sometime this month once the inside has been fully furnished. And we were up in the air again with our Redline heli. Thanks to this, we can get a good idea of the progress on other parts of the build site. Mainly the office building, which is currently the only building with major work still left on the exterior. But that may not be the case for much longer, as work on most of the main section's flooring is complete. Thanks to this view, we can also see that it appears SpaceX won't be expanding on this side of the building as originally thought. It was believed that the office building would consist of 3 equally sized sections, but now it is clear that one of these sections will be a bit smaller. Seeing Starbase from the air is one of the coolest ways to experience the spaceport of the future. Did you know that you can take a helicopter ride over Starbase and see the same views as in our videos? Visit redlineheli.com/Felix to book your very own helicopter ride over Starbase with $25 off. You will never forget this. Looking away from the office building to the structure just next door, we see the Mega Bay. Also known as Mega Bay 1, this structure is used for the larger Super Heavy booster construction. The prototypes currently located here are Booster 13, Booster 14, sections of Booster 15, and Booster 12. Booster 12 is the Super Heavy prototype that is slated to fly on Flight Test 5. As SpaceX prepares for its 5th flight of Starship, it must undergo static fires of both the first stage and second stage vehicles. As you might remember, Ship 30 was static fired before Flight 4 and will only be rolled out once it is time for flight. Booster 12, on the other hand, has yet to see any flames. That is why it's preparing for its own test campaign. This is why a road closure for the 3rd was posted for a booster roll. But I talked about it before. Despite all signs pointing to Booster 12, the rollout ended up being for the aforementioned tower roll. Yet another curveball from SpaceX. And if life throws a curveball at you, this might help you. Alright, let's use the time to thank our longtime partner and sponsor, Surfshark VPN, a service we use regularly, especially when we need to access websites or content that are geo-blocked. With Surfshark VPN, you can get an IP address from anywhere around the world, allowing you to bypass geo-restrictions and enjoy your favorite content. Whether it's accessing global rocket launch streams, space documentaries, or international tech conferences, Surfshark has you covered. When we moved from Germany to the US over 2 years ago, we couldn't access some of the German TV channels and websites. Surfshark VPN allowed us to keep this access and stay connected to what's happening in our old home. Just imagine two starships filled with astronauts on their way to the moon or Mars, all covered by Surfshark VPN, staying connected with their home countries and families. Surfshark lets you use the service on an unlimited amount of devices. If you use our code FELIX, you'll get 4 months extra for free. Just click the link below or use the code. Thank you, Surfshark. Now let's get back to exploring the cosmos. Surfshark, surf with your own set of rules. All right, back to our curveball personally dealt out to us by SpaceX. Although we haven't seen it roll yet, Booster 12 will likely be out to the launch site very soon. This super heavy Starship vehicle will likely feature many upgrades over the last booster to verify this flight goes as planned. After all, it is supposed to be caught. They will also likely check each of these engines thoroughly, as Booster 11 had two of its engines shut down at one point during the flight. And then there is one more bay that we should have a look at. The second mega bay. This building took the better part of last year to build, and now its exterior is nearly complete. Since the structure was completed, SpaceX has mostly been outfitting the inside before it begins operations. The building is only used for one thing currently: engine installation. However, this doesn't really count, as this process was completed outdoors before Ship 29. This basically means that the building hasn't been used for any type of stacking yet. It's only a matter of time before SpaceX makes this building operational and ready to host its first official ship. Who knows, maybe Ship 31 will be the first to call Mega Bay 2 home, or SpaceX will wait until the first Block 2 starships come out of the Star Factory. Now let's move to the High Bay, where the upper stage prototype for Flight 5 is currently being retiled. As you can see from these pictures, Ship 30 has its tiles reinstalled after removing them to add this peculiar ablative layer underneath. This layer fits beneath the tiles and will protect the ship as a last line of defense if any tiles come loose or melt away. This makes a lot of sense, but it is also not the final solution. Added weight and not easy to reuse. It's a hotfix. Get it? Get it? This layer has already been installed across the entire ship except for the nose cone tip and flap hinges. The nose cone is protected and actively cooled by the cryogenic tanks within, and the layer on the flap hinges will likely come later down the line. Since this layer has been added, teams have been working away adding the new and stronger tiles to the ship. We've even seen some tiles added to the flap surface, although there are relatively few. This whole process of tile reinstallation should be done in the next week or so, and then we will see what SpaceX decides to do about the hinges. These were the failure points during Flight 4, and according to Musk, they need a major update. This all means we'll likely see extra heat protection and reinforcement in those areas. We might also see a complete redesign of the hinge itself, although this is rather unlikely on this vehicle due to the timeline they want Flight 5 to fulfill. We also spotted this. An odd-looking ring that was moved inside the high bay. It features two rings welded together and has stringers on one side. Currently, its future is unknown, but we can speculate. It may act as a test tank for structural testing similar to what B14.1 was. This kind of prototype testing is always exciting. Once it's completed for strength testing, it might be moved to Massey's, or it may remain in the high bay and be used as a weld test article. This ring may be used to test techniques that will be used on the upcoming Block 2 starships, which would explain why it is showing its face. What do you think? How long will it take for the first full Block 2 starship to appear? Tell us what you think in the comments below. If you've been paying attention to these pictures, you'll notice a prototype missing from this building. One of them was on the move, and this is a very important move. Sparky is back. Ship 31, which was previously located in the high bay, has now been relocated to Massey's test site. This won't be the first time this vehicle has been here. In fact, Ship 31 has been to Massey's for testing before. Just a couple of weeks ago, Ship 31 experienced an electrical malfunction with an unknown cause. This malfunction aborted testing, severely damaging the prototype and caused it to be rolled back to the high bay. Some speculated that this vehicle would be scrapped as refurbishment might take too long, but it appears that SpaceX has other plans for Sparky. They were able to save it. So after fixing earlier this week, Ship 31 was rolled to Massey's for another round of testing. This includes another round of cryogenic proof testing in which cryogenic nitrogen is loaded into the ship to verify that all the components can withstand the necessary temperatures and pressures. This very test is what caused problems for Ship 31 last time, and it even prompted them to check Ship 29 before Flight 4. But it does look like SpaceX was able to fix that problem. On July 2nd, Ship 31 was seen getting a bit frosty as SpaceX filled the ship with nitrogen. The test appeared to have gone perfectly, and we'll likely see another one in the upcoming days, only this time with thrust simulation, where hydraulic rams are placed where the engines would be and pushed with the force of an engine to mimic conditions during flight. Now, Sparky isn't the only thing at Massey's. We also have the new Can Crusher 2.0, which appears to have received pulley mounts along some of its levels. Thanks to our flyover, we can also see SpaceX has moved the pieces for the next section closer in preparation for it to grow. Will this be the last section of the new Can Crusher? What do you think it will be used for? What will they test with it? Leave your thoughts in the comments. I love reading them. Our next big story might sound a bit familiar to those of you who regularly keep up with the show. A hurricane is on its way to Starbase. Again? Yep, just a couple of weeks ago, we talked about Tropical Storm Alberto, which dumped a lot of rain on Starbase, but not much else. Well, Hurricane Beryl is now heading along a very similar path, but this storm is much stronger. Currently, it is a Category 5. Yeah, 5. Its winds top out at 145 miles per hour or 233 kilometers per hour. That is abysmal. So, is Starbase doomed? Fortunately, Starbase forecasts have it weakening to a tropical storm or Category 1 by the time it reaches Boca Chica. However, given the conditions in the Gulf of Mexico and the hurricane's travel speed, it will likely be on the higher end of that estimate. It is set to make landfall around midday on the 6th, so watch for that. It will be less powerful when it hits Starbase, but it currently hits places like Jamaica and Mexico at full power. Starbase got luckier than these places, but it might not be lucky forever. In fact, there is likely yet another hurricane just a week behind Beryl. Moving on to the other side of the world, we have a static fire from China. Wait, not a launch? China, the other player in the so-called space race of the future, has had few issues getting its rockets off the ground. As a matter of fact, they seem to be having a hard time keeping them on the ground. On June 30th, China was set to undergo a static fire of its brand new Tianlong 3 rocket. The rocket is special because it is planned to be partially reusable and capable of an autonomous vertical landing. This is very similar to the Falcon 9 landing. And this hot fire test was meant to verify the 9 Kerolox engines on the first stage. Simple. But this test went horribly wrong, to say the least. According to Pioneer Space, the company behind Tianlong 3, the test stand malfunctioned and could no longer hold the rocket down. That is bad. In addition, according to the original patent, the test stand was apparently only rated for 600 tons of thrust, while the vehicle has over 800 tons of thrust at its lowest throttle. The stand was carried over from the Tianlong 2 program. This is not uncommon, but it makes upgrades necessary. So it might be that these needed upgrades were either not performed at all or something went wrong, causing the vehicle to break free of the stand and begin its unplanned ascent. It eventually stopped and began plummeting to the ground before exploding. Possible engine failures can also be seen. In addition, the spectacle took place 3 kilometers away from the large metropolitan city of Gongji. Although there were luckily no casualties, it is not clear yet if there were any injuries, which is concerning to say the least. Let's just hope that this was not caused by neglect, but by genuine mistakes, which happen and are there to learn from them. Remember, launching a rocket, no matter how significant it may be, is never worth risking the life of anyone. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button. Subscribe for more awesome content. This is what fuels the algorithm and it helps us immensely. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A link is in the description. And if you want to train your space IQ even further, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching and I'll see you again in the next episode. Prompted them to check chip shep in the hoop-de-doo pairs frickety frick ship shep shop ship shibbity ship ha tippity bip. Chibbity shoppity shop.